been a long time coming, so tonight is a big night for me, so I'm really grateful for you all for being a part of it. I want to thank a few people. Jim LaPata is my life coach, and he has helped me get through the process of driving my heels as I've been trying to work on this. David Shepker, who I met at Journey to Elderhood last year, is a director in New York, and he got interested in the piece I was working on. He's been working with me on it. I want to thank Freddie Freeman, who is my sound designer. He made magic this last week and has really helped elevate the show. I want to thank Sine, my stage manager, who's going to do the cues for me today. I want to thank Poodle, who helped with lighting and supported me today. I want to thank Justin and Adam, two original members from Snapdragon Productions, which you guys will hear about in the show, who came up from New York to support me. And again, I want to thank you all for coming out tonight and giving me an audience and a group of people to share this with. Okay. I've got my white wine over there, just in case the nerves get to me. Alright, so yeah, this is a piece I've been working on for a couple years now, and it's about my relationship with drag and gender. And without further ado, I present to you On and Off Again.
Expecting company, but you are welcome. Each and every one of you, especially you. I'm Sylvia London, and since you're all here, as soon as I'm done with my bath, I'm going to tell you a story. A story about love and loss, wise elders, sex, booze, drag queens, radical fairies, a magical book, and a long-ass road trip. You'll hear it all, just as soon as I'm done with my bath. You see, on nights that I have a drag gig, I always like to start my process with a long, luxurious bubble bath. It's become a ritual. I soak in the bubbles, drinking something bubbly, and let the troubles of this man-eat-man world wash away. Effortlessly, my skin becomes softer, smoother, sweeter, my mind more at ease, my body more relaxed and present to the sensual, sacred, feminine energy flowing through it. Sorry. Sometimes I get carried away, but I do love a bubble bath. It's a wonderful place to think. Can we push back against the cisgendered, able-bodied, white supremacist, capitalist, misogynist, heteropatriarchal hegemony? Perhaps I should have gone with the rouge noir instead of the bruised plum lipstick shade today. What is it really that makes a man, and a woman? Is it the clothes he wears, the hair she combs, the shoes that fit their feet? Is it the way he sits, the way she stands, or what other people think? When in my process do I switch from Will to Sylvia, from he to she? You know, sometimes I get a last-minute drag gig, and I have to skip the bubble bath ritual altogether and get ready at the bathroom of the club I'm working at. I know, real glamorous, the bathroom of the club. It's usually before they open, so except for a bartender or an occasional cocktail waitress, it's pretty private, but I still like to be considerate, so I start the process in the men's room. Blushing out the cheeks, putting on the foundation, well, foundation first, and then it's the eye details. And then blushing out the cheeks. Oh, hey there, dude. And then I take my drag bag and I sneak into the women's room.
I slip into the handicap stall. It's always roomier in there. And then I slip on my dress, put on my heels, and of course my hair. Finally, I go to the mirror, I put on my lipstick. I take one final look, and something within me shifts. I am woman, hear me roar, in numbers too big to ignore, and I know too much to go back and pretend, cause I heard it all before, and I've been down there on the floor. And no one's ever gonna keep me down again. Oh, yes, I'm wise, but it's wisdom born of pain. Yes, I paid the price, but look how much I gained. If I had to, I can do anything. I am strong,
strong.
I am invincible. I am woman. So much. I do love that song. But I must admit, I haven't always been the strong, confident drag queen you see before you this evening. You see, my drag journey has been a long one. It all started with a broken heart. Where our story begins is the year 2000, the dawn of a new millennium, the nation full of hope. And yours truly, Sylvia London, is but a glimmer in the eye of a young Will Fisher, fresh out of college and ready to start his adult life in NYC. I am so fucking excited. I'm about to take a road trip where I'll be going all the way from sunny San Diego to the Big Bad Apple. I cannot wait to start my life in the best city in the world with the best boyfriend in the world, my love, Elon. He's the rabbi's son, and he's dreamy. We fell in love in the springtime, and get this, I'm his first boyfriend. He likes to tell me how all the love songs on the radio suddenly make sense. And we like to stay up late, drinking cheap red wine and listening to Nina Simone and Billie Holiday and Ella Fitzgerald. He has a thing for black female vocalists. And he's dreamy and I love him. I remember the first time I told him, it was on Passover. We went to his parents' house in Waterford, and after this long, ceremonious meal with lots of l'chaims, we're finally lying in bed together, a single bed, our faces pressed up against each other, sharing Manischewitz breath. And then he said it, I love you. And I said it back, I love you too. And then we just kept saying it and kissing, I love you. Over and over, I love you again. After college, we ran off to Europe and hopped from one magical city to the next, and then he went back to Connecticut and I came here to my parents' house in San Diego so we could save some money before moving to New York City together. It's been really hard being apart all these months, but the longing and waiting are finally coming to an end. I'm just about packed and I'm so ready to just be in this life. Guess who? Hi, honey. Yeah, I'm good. I'm just about packed, and I'm so ready to see you and kiss you. What's up? Oh, yeah, sure. What's up? Is something wrong? Elon dumped me. Just like that.
It's over. Just like that. You know, no one ever told me what heartbreak feels like. Fuck. I don't know what to do with myself. So I go shopping. It seems like the logical thing to do.
Like what Carrie Bradshaw and her gal pals from Sex and the City would do after a breakup. If you're gonna be in New York, you might as well start acting like one, right? So I buy some sexy jeans that make my ass look like I have an ass. I buy some fancy dress shoes, some home accessories. There's nothing like retail therapy.
I even buy some drag. You see, I tried drag once or twice, and I thought I'd try it again in New York. I found this white vinyl top with hot pink feathers, and a matching white vinyl miniskirt with the same hot pink feathers. So good.
For my last stop, I went to this old bookstore on a side street near the mall.
Entering the store, I had a strange feeling come over me. I'd never been here before, but it felt so familiar, like maybe from a dream. I'm wandering the aisles, not sure what I'm looking for, and I nod at the old man behind the counter who silently nods back. He doesn't say anything, but his eyes, through his gold rimmed glasses, seem to point me to the aisle on the far right side of the store. As I walk, I feel a strange pull to the round corner, where a stream of late afternoon sun shines through the window. I read Gay Soul, Finding the Heart of Gay Spirit and Nature with 16 writers, healers, teachers, and visionaries. I didn't know it yet, but this was what I was shopping for all day. Well, this and the white vinyl TVs. I'm leaving for my road trip tomorrow, and I think I'm finally ready. But the next day, I think of Elon and that empty feeling in my heart mixed with the anxiety. The move is sickening. Fuck it, I'm moving to NYC with or without him. I've packed all my bags in the hand-me-down Oldsmobile my parents have agreed to let me take to NYC. And let's just say there's an emphasis on the old in this Oldsmobile. It's sort of a faded bronze color on the outside with a crushed velvet interior. Luxurious in its day, perhaps, but now just kind of sad. My stuff is so full and crammed that I nearly scrape the pavement as I pull out of my parents' driveway. They stand on the front lawn to see me off, Dad waving a goofy dad smile, Mom holding tightly onto the dog's leashes and tightly onto her tears so they don't spill out. As I pull out of San Diego, I catch a glimpse of the Pacific Ocean in my rearview mirror, and my tears start to spill out. It's about then that I realize that I'll be doing this for the next 41 hours over 5 straight days. Nothing but this. Now, what I've realized since that first heartbreak is that when you're dealing with a heartbreak, it's best to keep kind of busy to distract yourself, otherwise you might start obsessing. With that in mind, an activity that I would not recommend right after a heartbreak is to drive across the fucking country. I try to distract myself with some music. I don't know.
Suddenly, all the heartbreak songs on the radio made sense. felt so damn sorry for myself, and I couldn't stop crying. Sometimes I cry so hard that I have to pull off the road because I can't see through my tears. Like when you're driving through a rainstorm and it's pouring so hard that the windshield wipers can't keep up. Eventually, after 12 hours of sobbing and driving, I checked into a Motel 8 in Albuquerque, New Mexico. As I'm unpacking my stuff, I see the white vinyl two-piece with the hot pink feathers, and I consider recreating that scene from Priscilla, Queen of the Desert, where one of the drag queens driving across Australia in a big pink bus, she gets all done up in drag in some Hicksville town, tries to meet some local trade, nearly gets herself killed. I don't want to risk my life in New Mexico. Instead, I pull out my new book. It's a series of interviews by Mark Thompson with leaders from the gay spirituality movement. Gay spirituality. Never even heard of that concept before. Each interview offers wisdom through the words of these elders who talk about what's special about being gay in the world today. I sit on the stiff double bed in the generically decorated motel room and open it up. I'm quickly transported, swimming through a sea of sparkly queer wisdom. I read the words of Andrew Harvey, "Hearts were made to break." By accepting heartbreak and allowing the heart to break again and again without fear or consolation, a space is opened in the heart in which the whole universe can be placed. Such vulnerability is sacred, I believe, and the source of the highest and most luminous forms of strength. I read chaos can either destroy us or provide us the pain and energy for our transformation and press us to define ourselves more clearly and fiercely. In a bad time, let obstacles become the spurs to enlightenment. We have to learn how to become phoenixes and rise again and again out of the ashes of humiliation, desolation, and grief. These words are so powerful and true, they felt like they were speaking directly to my wounded heart. But they were also hard to take in, like I understood the concepts in my head, but I couldn't feel them yet. I pass out with the book still open, hoping the wisdom might seep in while I slept. But Elon is the first thing I think of the next day. And that same empty feeling in my heart is there. But I have to drive home. Back to this. Today I'm not quite as weepy, but now I'm obsessed over why he did it. I keep beating myself up for not asking. I'd been so stunned in the moment that I couldn't muster anything but silence, and now it's driving me fucking nuts. After 7 hours of driving and obsessing, I pull over into this kind of ghost townish spot near Amarillo, Texas, and I stop at this abandoned little park and lean up against an old oak tree, and then I do exactly what you're not supposed to do 2 days after a breakup. I call my ex. "Hi, yeah, just driving away." I finally get up the nerve. Big breath. "So, why exactly did you break up with me?" And then I hear, "I realize I was attracted to you like I'm attracted to black female vocalists." "Like Ella?" "Okay. I didn't know what to say. I wish I'd said, well, I'm not a black female vocalist per se, but I do have strength, I do have grace, and I do have soul. And if soulful loving is not the kind of loving you're looking for, I can surely swish away. And may one day I find a man who says to me I'm attracted to you like I'm attracted to a black female vocalist, and that's why my love for you is so damn strong. That man, yes, that man is the man for me." What the fuck?
the only way I can really interpret that is that I was too feminine for him or something. He definitely hinted at that sometimes. I remember we were walking down a canal in Amsterdam and something startled me. It gasped and he said, "Why are you so skittish all the time? Man up." He also mentioned once that if I worked out, I could have a more masculine looking body. And I guess my body is kind of girlish. There was also that time I did drag and he seemed really embarrassed. Maybe that's what did it. Maybe drag is some unforgivable turnoff. I mean, what does it say about me that I like putting on women's clothes? Why did I even do it in the first place? Holly Kolke. Holly Kolke. That's who first did me up in drag. It was the ninth grade. We were 16 years old in the early 90s when Holly taught me about Morrissey and espresso and Shakespeare and the word chic and the chicness of an all-black ensemble. She was fucking cool and she liked hanging out with me, which was a good thing because all my A-list friends had just dropped me when rumors spread that I shop for women's lingerie and stuff gerbils up my ass like Richard Gere.
Yeah,
eighth grade really sucked. But at least I had Holly, and our nights at the Panican Cafe where we listen to live jazz and sip cappuccinos and flip through black and white photography books and talk about how stupid everyone was. It was awesome. But things started to change when Holly started to crush on me. I was still in denial that I was gay, so I asked her out. I remember our first date to the San Diego Wild Animal Park. I nervously grabbed her hand at the bird show as the condors flew under the audience's heads. As we left, she pointed at two men in front of us, also holding hands. She laughed. I'd never seen that before. I grabbed hers tighter, feeling terrified and excited. Eventually, I came out to her, and she was like, "Oh my god, am I that ugly? Did I turn you gay?" She got over it, though, when she got this super butch Mexican-Italian homie-type boyfriend named Angelo. She had him wrapped around her little finger, and the three of us started hanging out and somehow got along famously. So, this one night, Priscilla, Queen of the Desert, had just come out, and they were having a premiere event in Hillcrest, San Diego's gay neighborhood, where they were letting everyone dressed in drag in for free. This seemed like a great excuse to try drag for the first time, and I got Holly to agree to get me ready and be my date, and she got Angelo to agree to come with us. So I go to Holly's house, and she puts me in one of her cocktail dresses, this sleek, soft, black number. A pair of her simple black heels, and a flirty red bob cut wig. She does my makeup like she does her own, a cat shadow eye, a rouge cheek, and a deep red lip. And take a look in the mirror. Oh my god, I look gorgeous! Get me to the premiere, sweetie! I'm ready for the red carpet! Just as we're leaving, Holly's mom catches her in a lie, and now she's not about to let Holly run off with her gangster boyfriend and her gay ex-boyfriend in a dress to go see some queer movie about drag queens. Oh, her night is ruined. But Holly has a plan B. She convinces Angelo to be my date. And I was not complaining. Darlings, it was a marvelous night. We walked right past the ticket line. We posed for pics for the paparazzi. We entered the theater where the drag queen hostess beckoned me to join all the other queens strutting their stuff across the stage. My first time in the drag spotlight. The movie was fantastic. The crew of drag sisters, was performing ABBA along the way. It was so inspiring. After the movie, I paraded Angela past all the jealous queens. I think he enjoyed the attention. But eventually, we had to make curfew. So, I drop Angela off and start driving down the twisty mountain roads towards my parents' house. As I drive, something compels me to touch myself. I'm getting excited as I feel my boyhood beneath my silky, soft dress. The roads get twistier and my cock gets hard and I start to stroke it. Headlights illuminate tall, gnarly eucalyptus trees. Windows open, the air whipping through my flirty red bob cut wig as I stroke and turn and stroke and turn. The sleek dress rubbing up and down against my hard 16-year-old cock as I stroke and turn and stroke and turn. I catch a glimpse of myself in the rearview mirror and feel like a red-headed slut jacking off her teenage stud as I stroke and turn and stroke and turn and stroke and turn and bam! I slam on the brakes just before crashing headfirst into a huge eucalyptus tree as my cock explodes. White cum shoots out all over Holly's black cocktail dress. The smell of eucalyptus and my sweet seed fills my nostrils, and a new part of me is born. Holly Colgate. And that's who first did me up in drag. No. If I really think about it, the real first time, I was just a little boy, maybe 7 or 8. At that time, I used to worship my older sisters. They were the coolest and prettiest girls in their San Diego junior high schools. They both had like totally 80s hair. Josie, the older one, she used to blow hers out and aqua spray it until it was really big. And Cinnamon, yeah, her name is Cinnamon, she had bangs that she grew out so they swept across her face, making her only able to see out of one eye. They used to flip their hair, and I used to watch them and try to do it with my floppy blonde boy locks. Everything they did, I did. Everything they liked, I liked. From Cabbage Patch Kids, the Bangles, they were my Egyptians, and I wanted to walk like them. So this one night, Cinnamon has a slumber party, where she invites all the most popular girls in her class, and they're all hanging out, and I stayed up late with them playing the cute younger brother role, laughing at all their jokes, and one of them says, like, oh my god, Cinnamon, we should totally do your little brother as a makeup. Woo! They all squeal with laughter, sit me down, and start painting my face. I pretend like I don't like it, because somehow I know that's what I'm supposed to do. Before I know it, bright blue splashes above my eyes, hot pink sweeps across my cheeks, and deep red sinks into my lips. I catch a glimpse in the mirror, and all resistance drops. Still was peeking out, and I had liked her. I finally felt like I was really one of the girls. Like, oh my god, let's totally put on the Bangles! Cinnamon's Cabbage Patch doll, my head down in shame, wishing so badly I had long blonde hair like all of them that I could hide behind.
Cinnamon, what the hell is wrong with you? You girls need to quiet down. Willie, wash that crap off your face and go to bed.
Mom wouldn't have been so mad, I think, as I walked to the bathroom here. I'm embarrassed and upset. But not enough to keep me from posing a few more times in the mirror. I then washed it off, but I did it so that it looked like I tried, but I left some of it on so I could see my pretty little
girl face again in the morning.
I still do that sometimes after a drag gig. I leave a little bit of the mask behind.
Yeah.
Eyeliner or a glitter brow. Something to remind me of the magic that I held the night before. Driving across the country that day, drag didn't feel like a magical gift, it felt like a fault. There must be something wrong with me. I finally come around to accepting myself as a gay guy, but clearly I'm something else. I'm watching the sun set on the plains of Illinois, turning the dry corn leaves pink, and I think of the white vinyl two-piece with the hot pink feathers. I wish I hadn't bought it. I wish I hadn't loved trying it on. I feel ashamed of my joy. That night, I check into another Motel 8. I set up a feast from Taco Bell in my bed. And in between my Nacho Supreme and my Taco Bell Grande, sits the gay soul. Tonight I read about the Verdache, also known as Two-Spirit. It's a Native American term for people who embody both male and female identities. Clyde Hall says Verdache walk in both worlds because you are elements of both male and female, but you're neither. You don't fit in, you're a go-between. And consequently, it's easier for you to transcend from the physical to the spiritual realm. That's pretty cool. Will Roscoe, he says, the Verdache that I know today all have lots of awareness of self. They are what you call queens. When they come into a room, you know it. They make the party a good party. They connect, they speak the truth, and they're blunt. They're fearless, and will do anything without consideration of social convention or gender boundaries. I am part Native American, Osage. I think maybe that's what I am. I take my last bite of my Taco Supreme. I wipe the sour cream off my face and think maybe this isn't such a bad thing. And pass out. The next day, it sucks all over again. And I'm so sick of obsessing, stuck on these barren, never-ending highways. I can't take it anymore. Fuck it. I'm gonna drive all night if I have to. I'm getting to NYC. And I do drive all night. But at 6:23 a.m., I finally catch my first glimpse of the glorious city that is New York. The rising sun silhouettes the iconic skyline, and I'm immediately in awe and in love. Now I'm in New York. After arriving in the Big Apple, I quickly find all the distractions from heartbreak I so desperately needed. A whole city of distractions, and the gays. Yeah, the gays, there were so many different kinds of them. Who knew that homos came in such a wide variety of shapes and sizes and personalities? There were gay punks and twinks and bears, oh my! Muscle queens, show queens, drag queens, otters, cubs, wolves, gay geeks, gay jocks, out gay professionals, house boys, circuit boys, Chelsea boys, Kelsey boys, bearded Brooklyn fags, art fags, lady fags, the list goes on and on and on. That's not even mentioning all the queers. We'll be here all night. But what was most exciting for me was that encompassed in all these beautiful queers and gays was this vast range of gender expression like I'd never seen before. It really blew my mind, and I began to see all the possible expressions of gender stretching out before me, like a line stretching across the city, with the butchest of the butch on one side, the femmiest of the femme on the other. Here, let me show you. Ladies, gentlemen, two-spirits, butches, femme, genderqueer, and the rest of you, I present to you the gender line.
Let's see. Let's try this out. Get over here. Try it.
Fuck yeah! Fuck yeah! I feel strong and powerful!
That's interesting. Yes, darling, it's right here. And I, well, I sort of danced across the line, depending on the day and the scenario. And when I first moved to New York City, I really wanted to dance. I felt rebellious. Villon wasn't going to love me because I was too femme, then fuck it, I was going to be super femme. That white vinyl two-piece with the hot feathers had been calling my name all the way across the city, and I was ready to ruffle those feathers, honey. But as fate would have it, Weekstock, the Lady Money's drag queen festival, was happening the week after I arrived. A perfect excuse for Sylvia London to make her NYC debut. Oh! Oh! Seeing all those gorgeous queens strut their stuff across Chelsea Piers, their sequins and glitter sparkling in the sunlight, it was magic. My white vinyl two-piece with the hot pink feathers was a hit. I felt like one of the girls. Fuck heartbreak. I'm Sylvia London, an NYC drag queen and proud of it. I quickly found my drag crew. A group of ladyboys fresh out of drama school and ready to grab NYC by the balls. We started a guerrilla drag troupe called Snapdragon Productions and started throwing parties and producing events in downtown clubs and bars. The troupe was made up of me, Mimi Valdez, Agatha Christie, Galactica, Princess Anorexia, Crystal Snow, Shania Rendezvous, Petra, and Justin Scott. Our drag stylist and handler. Our shows were often elaborate and demented. Like we did an onstage sex change operation to Gwen Stefani's I'm Just a Girl. We also did players' balls with wacky themes like Pimp Circus and Whores of Jupiter. And then we started a monthly party in Brooklyn called Blow. Spelled B-L-O with an accent over the O. Monosyllabic party names were really hot. We didn't really make much money because there was a lot of us, but as long as there was drink tickets, we didn't care. But to save on money, we'd skip the expensive cab rides and take the subway in full drag. It usually wasn't a problem, but, well, one time it really was. You see, Agatha Christie and I had booked a gig working the holiday party for Crunch Gym. It was taking place at Plaid, which used to be called Spa. Monosyllabic. So they were looking for acts that were unusual, and Agatha tells the producers that we were fortune-telling drag queens. She said she'd read a book about the tarot and we'd be fine. So I go to Hag's apartment. She lives with Galactica. And this apartment is a very narrow railroad apartment in Hell's Kitchen, which inevitably always became a sea of heels and wigs and dresses. It was like a glitter hair grenade exploded in the hallway. So we pull out every single piece of drag from their closet, and then finally decide to go with some leftover pieces from this number that was a Gem in the Holograms versus the Misfits production number, which ended with Gem beheading Pizzazz in slow motion. Drag queen fortune tellers who were punk rock, so. Why not? I show up to the club. I'm wearing a hot pink and jet black slip wig with a tiny black leather mini skirt, hot pink fishnet stockings, big black cuffs, and a tight top hugging my birdseed-filled pantyhose tits. The gig was great. The more drinks we had, the more elaborate we got with people's fortunes, telling them about their career paths, love lives, babies on the way, deaths on the horizon. sell people trust fortune tellers who are punk rock drag queens. Before they find out we're frauds, we book it to our favorite after-hours spot, the Cock, and party till closing, and then stumble to our trains. I make it home to Brooklyn safe and sound. But when I go to get my keys, to my horror, I realize I've left them in my pant pocket, buried under a sea of drag in Hell's Kitchen. So, I get back on the train, 5 in the morning, in full punk rock drag, and head to Midtown. I'm at the end of the F line. In fucking Queens! No way, it gets worse. My purse with my wallet and my phone are missing, and people are getting on the train wearing business suits on the way to work. I try to cover my punk rock slutty drag look and hide from their judgy stares behind my two-tone flip wig, wishing so badly it were long and blonde. Proceed to take the longest subway ride of my life, followed by the longest walk of my life. This creepy man asking where to go for a good time. This is a whole new level of walk of shame. I nearly break down in tears, but finally arrive at their apartment where I profess I will never fuck with fortune telling again. I take off my wig. Decide it's time to take a little break from drag. The partying had become a bit much. Plus, I miss having a boyfriend, and prancing around in pumps didn't seem like the best way to find one. So, I convinced Justin to join me for an underwear party. We read a listing in the back of HX Magazine, Hot Brooklyn Underwear Party for Fit Guys Under 30. Clothes check out the door. The thought a party in our underwear was terrifying and exciting. We arrive at the party. We strip down to our undies, put our bags in a garbage bag clothes bag, then enter to see all these sexy 20-somethings milling about in designer underwear. It's a hot scene. Bare skin, big bulges lit up by bright blue bowls. Party bubbling, drag for once, loud, makeup, heels. It's just us dudes hanging out with our packages on display. And I know what to do, so I get a drink. And I mill it out with him. I see him. He's a short, stocky, Jewish guy, wearing boxers. He's got dark, curly hair and a sly, charming smile. We make eye contact and then he approaches. I find out his name is James. James is one sexy dude. He's trying to play cool and I am too, but eventually he told me maybe he'd never been to anything like this before. And he takes my hand and leads me to one of the darker rooms where we discover some hot sexual chemistry. A week later, we go on a date which lasts 24 hours, and before we know it, we're fully fledged boyfriends. Sometimes it just happens like that. I was on cloud nine. He's my first boyfriend since Elon broke my heart, and he was perfect. He was shorter than me, which I liked because it made me feel like a tall, luxurious supermodel. And he was smart and responsible and great in bed, and he was creative and talented and great in bed. And another thing, he was great in bed. No, but seriously, he was also a family man. He wanted to have kids one day, which is a dream of mine too. I could really see a future with this guy. But there were some things, like he was not that open-minded and he was less than accepting about the whole drag thing. I was willing to extend my break from Sylvia for a while, if that's what was needed.
My sister is, of course, worth having it, saying, who does she think she is? She gets this geeky boyfriend, and now she doesn't need us. There was little they could do, and without my energy behind Snapdragon, our guerrilla drag troupe sort of dwindled away. I didn't care. I'm my man now. But sometimes, I would miss Sylvia. I would hear her whisper in my ear. I might be watching some queen at a club command the room, and I hear. Remember that magic? That was yours and Candy's too. See that beauty? That larger-than-life presence? See how she serves the adoring crowd? You can serve that too. Don't you miss that heightened state of being? Don't you miss that feminine energy coursing through your veins? Don't you miss... And I did. But I didn't want to risk it with James, so I'd push her deeper into the closet. One night, she really got out. My mom was visiting. Now, my mom loves my gay friends. She feels like she could let her hair down and not be judged for her eccentric ways. They love her right back. They've adopted her as their own. They call her Mama Fisher. She calls them her posse. So this one visit, mom's visiting, and Peter decides to throw a barbecue in her honor at this white stone mansion where he serves as the resident houseboy up in Harlem. And mom comes to the party. She brings this mysterious bag with her. And then after cocktails and hamburgers, the bag comes out. And then, with James watching from the corner, my friends are all invited to go to the bag and pull out gifts. Gifts of women's lingerie. Oh, and now it's my turn. Go on, girl, do it, Sylvia. And so I nervously reach into the bag and pull out a bright pink lacy bra. Why, yes, I'd love to try it on. Don't mind if I do. Sylvia London finally let out to play. Oh my god, as you all look gorgeous. I think it's time for a walk. Now, friends, bitches, work those panties, Petra. Oh my god, I'm having so much fucking fun. I see James. Straight-faced, arms crossed, staring. While my friends and I are laughing and prancing, he's just staring. And I want so badly for him to smile, to laugh, to see that what we're doing isn't wrong and ridiculous and fucked up, it's just fun. But maybe it is wrong and ridiculous and fucked up. I mean, what kind of mother-son relationship involves a mother giving her son and his queenie friends pieces of women's lingerie? But if it is wrong and ridiculous and fucked up, mom didn't care. She was celebrating our feminine spirits. And the sun was shining into the white room, lighting up the purple and pink and lemon and lime lingerie, so lovely and lacy and full of laughter, so frilly and free and full of frivolity. Mom's love lighting up our queer spirits, like the sun lighting up the brightly colored lingerie. That night, I stayed up late, sitting on the bed in Mom's hotel room, reading passages I'd underlined from The Gay Soul.